Hello everyone and welcome to today's webinar, Helping Children and Families After Disaster. My name is Julie Looper-Coates and I'm the Senior Preparedness Advisor on the Emergency Preparedness Team at Child Care Aware of America. Thank you for your interest. We've had over 300 individuals register for today's webinar. This is a timely and very important topic as many children, families, and caregivers are currently dealing with difficult emotions related to hurricanes, flooding, wildfires, and even violence. We're excited to have the expertise of staff from Sesame Street in Communities and Camp Noah in today's session. It has been a pleasure to work with them in preparing this webinar for all of you. Before we get started, I'd like to cover some webinar details. This webinar is being recorded and will be made available to all registrants within 1 week. Everyone who's in today's who is in attendance during today's live webinar will receive a certificate of attendance through email within 1 week. It will be sent to the email address that you registered with. A certificate of attendance will not be sent to those accessing the recorded webinar. You're in listen-only mode, so your phones are muted. We would love to hear from you though, so we encourage you to type any questions that you may have in the question box. My team members at Child Care Aware of America will be monitoring the questions that come in, and we will address as many questions as we can at the end of today's presentation. However, due to the large volume of participants, if we are unable to get to all questions, we will do our best to follow up with you with a response. I'd like to provide you a few tips related to the webinar screen. On the right, you should see a navigation panel. You can expand or collapse this panel by clicking on the orange arrow near the top. You'll see that we have included for today's session as indicated by the blue circled area on the screen. The yellow arrow is pointed to the area in which you can type a question. You may need to click on the small arrow in the gray section to expand this area to allow you to type your question. Today's webinar is the third session in a lineup of 5 webinars scheduled this fall and winter on child care disaster response and recovery topics. In November, Dr. David Schonfield, one of the nation's leading experts in helping children deal with loss and grief, will offer tips for helping children respond to the aftermath of disaster. And lastly, in December, we will shift our focus to resources that may be available through FEMA and other organizations for financial and resource assistance. We hope you can join us. The Emergency Preparedness Team at Child Care Aware of America has a large number of tools and resources related to preparedness, response, and recovery on our webpage, www.childcareprepare.org. We invite you to visit this site to sign up for the Child Care Emergency Preparedness Listserv and to receive updates and notifications on new resources that become available for the child care industry. Disaster changes lives, especially for children. Whatever type of disaster or trauma they have experienced, children often need support to process what has happened. Even in the most difficult of circumstances, children and families can find strength and resilience within their community. Today's guest presenters, Tara Forth from Sesame Street in Communities and Amanda Allen from Camp Noah, will share with you a variety of resources that their organizations make available to children and families to help them deal with the difficult emotions that are often present in the aftermath of a disaster. Tara Forth serves as Professional Development Manager in the U.S. Social Impact Department at Sesame Workshop. Tara is responsible for creating multimedia training and implementation experiences for various Sesame Workshop initiatives, sharing best practices and equipping providers across the nation with tools and resources to better serve families and children. Amanda Allen serves as Senior Program Manager of Camp Noah, a resiliency and preparedness day camp for children affected by natural disaster and other collective trauma. an awarded nonprofit professional, Amanda has over 20 years of experience working with a variety of organizations and programs across the Midwest, serving adults with disabilities, youth, and older adults. At this time, I'd like to welcome Tara to begin her presentation.
Great. Thank you so much, everyone, and thanks for joining us today. I think we've got a great audience, and I'm so glad you are joining us. As I said, my name is Tara, and I work here in the U.S. Social Impact Department at Sesame Workshop, and I'm excited to really just walk through a variety of resources that you can use either in your own work with kids and families or, you know, if you're a resource and referral agency that you can pass on to kids and families. So today we are going to talk through sort of the Sesame approach to supporting kids' social emotional well-being, and this is really applicable in the way that we create content, not only for emergency response, but also, you know, any difficult situation or tough topic that kids might be going through. We are going to take a deep dive into the Here for Each Other materials, which can be found online, and we also have physical toolkits available. So we're going to walk through the Here for Each Other, which is our emergency response curriculum and resources, and then we're going to take another look at some new resources that we have for you that you can extend to families or use in your own work on our new initiative, Sesame Street and Communities. So as we begin, I want to just go back to the beginning and what we're all about here at Sesame Workshop. So our mission is really to help kids and families grow smarter, stronger, and kinder. And, you know, we're almost 50 years old as an organization, and we have been trying to meet this mission by creating a variety of multimedia resources. So you are probably familiar with the TV show, but we also create, especially in the U.S. Social Impact Department, we also create resources specifically for families and kids and the providers who work with them to really support the work, support them in their tough transitions or in their difficult situations. So today we're going to be looking specifically at, of course, those difficult times and how we can really support families as they're going through these things. So, as we're looking at our content, as you dive in on your own to look at the resources that we have prepared for you, you'll notice that these four things are sort of our content approach. So, we always want to represent the child's perspective. You know, so often the small voice of a child is lost in the chaos of a difficult situation. So whether that's an emergency, maybe a hurricane or a flood, but that can also be, you know, any sort of traumatic experience, like the divorce of a parent, the incarceration of a loved one. All of these things have lots of big feelings, and the grown-ups going through these situations have all these big feelings and have so much to figure out. And it can be really hard for grown-ups to remember that kids are also experiencing these things. And they're experiencing them in a very different way because often they don't have a lot of context. They might not know what a hurricane is or why it keeps raining or, you know, why a parent has left or something like that. You know, they don't have a lot of context. And so it's really important for an adult to notice that a child is experiencing all kinds of things and then to contextualize the experience for them. The second thing we try to do is look for simple moments that make a really big impact. So we can be tempted to try to fix all the big things, to try to fix problems all at once or make everything better. But we know that what works a little bit better than trying to do everything in one fell swoop is to make consistent small changes. So that might be adopting a daily routine or even a weekly routine, sort of a ritual for kids to look forward to. And the things that parents and families can do together to, you know, that are small but can make a big difference. So we always want to look for those simple moments. And I really want to encourage you, especially if you're working for a resource and referral agency and you're extending resources to parents, or to programs in that matter, we're really going to cover a lot, and you might be tempted to give them everything all at once, but really try to sit down with a family or with a program and figure out what's going to be a good first step for them and offer that resource. So the third thing that we want to do when we're creating content is to remember that parents and caregivers really need to take care of themselves. So as I mentioned, you know, it's the role of the grown-up to notice that a child is going through something, but it's really kind of impossible to really be present and notice when the adult themselves is overwhelmed or, flooded with their own difficult feelings and heavy emotions. So we want to make sure to take care of parents, and that goes for caregivers as well, and providers like yourselves. So the last thing that we want to do when we're creating content is to recognize that big feelings are coming from all sides. So kids are having big feelings, parents are as well, and you as a provider working with a family might have some big feelings of your own. So to try to detach a little bit from the situation and know that everyone is going through something, and to sort of not take everything so personally, to sort of remove the emotion from it so that you can really offer the help that the family needs. So we provide language and modeling to help parents and providers do just that. So as I said, this is sort of our approach for supporting kids' emotional and social well-being in any sort of difficult situation, but we've created materials specifically for coping with emergencies, and that's what we're gonna look at now. Hopefully some of you are familiar with a project that we did with PSE&G a few years ago called Here for Each Other, and you can find this toolkit that I'm gonna go through on sesamestreet.org/toolkits/emergencies. And what you'll find there is basically a toolkit that's ready for you to either print out the resources, watch videos together, things to share with parents, tips for parents and caregivers, and you'll find it all there, and it's kind of neatly packaged for you. This is a quick look at the family guide. So we actually have several versions of the family guide. We have emergency specific versions of this, but this comes in a printable PDF version, but we also do have hard copies available of not only the Here for Each Other family guide, but also Let's Get Ready, which is emergency preparedness. And if you'd like to order those, they are free, and I think we have plenty in stock, so I can give instructions about that at the end. So let's take a closer look at the family guide. There's also a community provider guide. So some of you who are maybe working in a shelters type of facility or at a school or even at a resource referral agency might be interested in this provider guide. So let's take a look at what's inside. So this first activity is a printable, and it's called Elmo's Rainbow Hug. And what kids are asked to do is color in the rainbow, thinking of the things that make them feel happy and safe. And then you cut it out, and of course, Elmo can give himself a hug. So you can encourage kids to give themselves a hug when they're feeling scared or not safe. And we designed this really because first things first, you know, kids have to feel safe. They have to feel comfortable. And you know, when big things happen, when emergencies happen like this, it's just really important to offer a sense of security, a sense of comfort. And this is a really simple way, especially when resources are scarce, to offer that comfort in a playful way. Second, you will find a little activity sheet where you're asked to draw a picture of yourself, so the child can draw a picture of themselves, and then a helper. So a lot of our emergency preparedness materials cover, you know, who's in my neighborhood, who are my community helpers, Who are the people that are going to keep me safe? Who's sort of in my circle of care? And what, you know, what we want to do, especially in emergency situation and after a disaster, is that we're going to see more of these community helpers. And so we want to contextualize, why are there more right now? You know, what's the situation that they're helping us with? This is a good way to sort of contextualize that and talk about, you know, who's around right at this specific moment. The third thing I want to point out is a little Elmo Says worksheet. And this is a game that is like Simon Says, but it's Elmo Says. And you can do these activities that are fun and simple, good for all ages, and easily adaptable to different age groups. You can do this in sort of a group setting. And we created this to help you have an example of a creative play situation. So we know that resources can be scarce. Kids and families may have lost a lot of their material possessions, and they might not have their normal toys or comfort items around. But play and sort of taking a break from all of the big feelings that are going on is really important to helping kids heal and to helping make sure that families thrive in these situations. So it's good to get back to play, and this is a good example of a type of play that you don't need a lot of physical materials for. Oops. And then the last resource here is the family activity, which is our circle of care. And this is really created with parents in mind. When people go through these big situations and sort of the gravity of everything sets in for families and for parents especially, they can really start to feel lonely and isolated. And so we want to remind them, just as they want to remind their kids, that their kids are not alone. You know, we want to remind families and parents that they are not alone also, and that there are community members, there are friends and families to help them. And so doing this activity can really help sort of just think about who is there to support them. And remember, this is keeping in mind that parents and caregivers also need that emotional support during these hard times. This is a quick glance at some of the other family guides that are available, and they're emergency specific. So you can, they're basically the same with just a few different activities, a few different language tweaks there. So those are great in times of hardship. All right, and so we've just covered the toolkit page, which is on sesamestreet.org. But we also have a new website that is very robust, and it includes everything that we've just gone through and much more. So if you want to log on to sesamestreetandcommunities.org, you are welcome to visit there. You'll find over 400 activities that are very shareable. You'll find the emergency prep, you'll find the emergency response, but you'll also find topics that really run the gamut. They cover difficult times and tough talks. They cover healthy bodies, healthy minds, and of course, ABCs and 1-2-3s. And the special thing about this website is that it's parent and provider facing. So all of the content is created for adults and to really help parents engage with their kids and to help providers engage with families on a much deeper, more sustainable level. So I'm just going to walk through a few more of the emergency response materials, but also some emergency prep. And then I'm going to show you a variety of materials. So instead of just videos and printables, we really have a variety of multimedia resources. We've got videos, we've got storybooks and interactives. We've got workshops that are great for you providers who are working with families or fellow trainers, and we're going to practice one of those at the end. So hope you stay tuned for that. So this is an example of our Let's Get Ready sort of materials repurposed in Sesame Street and Communities. So there's a little song and a video about learning your whole names and learning your parents' whole names, which is always funny when kids don't know that their parents have have names other than mom or dad. So it's really important to help kids understand really who's the important people in their lives. And then we have a principle that goes along with that. So they can learn their name, they can also learn their address and their phone number, which are really critical things to helping families be reunited after an emergency or a disaster experience as well. This is a great example of an article that you'll find on Sesame Street and communities. And this is specifically for childcare providers. So I know there are some childcare providers in the audience today, and hopefully you've looked at this. We also have a webinar that kind of talks about some of this really important information about preparing your program and your facility and making sure you're getting the family involved in what your preparation and recovery plans are. So this is a worksheet and an article that really walks you through some things to think about and how to connect with families. And another thing that you'll find, of course, is videos. We're kind of known for videos. We are a media company. And I wanted to take a little bit of time to actually play through a short clip of one of the episodes that I think is really relevant right now. And it really highlights the child's perspective. So if you can take just a moment to think about how you work with kids and families, whether you're a child care provider, maybe you're a parent, maybe you're a resource and referral agency, maybe you can just think about how to how you work with kids and how you can apply some of the strategies that the grown-ups in this clip use with Big Bird. So just a little context, he's recently lost his nest because a hurricane came through Sesame Street and destroyed his nest, and which is very sad, and he's really shaken up about it. So he keeps repeating, "My nest, my home." And of course his friends on Sesame Street take care of him very well and keep up with his routines and things like that. But anyway, let's just take a quick listen and watch this clip, and then we'll talk. Well, hopefully you can reflect on what you've seen.
So Alan gave me a birdseed snack, and then Baby Bear, Elmo, and Alan sang me a lullaby, and I took my nap right in Hoover's store.
Oh, well, I'm glad you got to take your nap, Big Bird.
Yeah, it was nice. Oh, yeah.
What? Big Bird, where are you going?
Oh, I'm going to go take a look out the kitchen window and see how my nest is doing.
That sounded like a sad sigh, Big Bird.
Yeah, well, I do feel sad, Susan. I looked at my nest, and it's my home, you know. Still not ready.
Yeah, we know, Big Bird. But you know, you always have a home with us.
Oh, yeah, nice. Thank you.
You know, we're going to have dinner soon, but is there something you'd like to do before we eat?
Well, you know, Baby Bear drew a picture during the hurricane, and he said it made him feel better. So, I think maybe I'd like to draw a picture.
Yeah.
But, you know, I don't have anything to draw with because the hurricane blew everything away.
Well, you know, Big Bird, we've got crayons and paper right here.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Here you go.
Oh, boy. This is great.
What are you going to draw, Big Bird?
Let's see. I think I'd like to draw a picture of my nest, my home, before the hurricane messed everything up.
Hey, now, that's a good idea. All right. Okay. You know, we're going to go get dinner ready while you draw, okay?
Oh, yum, yum.
All right.
Okay.
See ya. So, how's the picture coming, Big Bird?
Gordon and I just finished it.
Oh, great.
Yeah.
Can I see?
Sure. Ta-da. Hey. See?
Yeah.
It's a picture of my home before the hurricane. There's my nest, my mailbox, my alphabet sign, my toy chest. That's me and my nest with radar.
Yeah.
Radar's very happy because he's home.
And you know, you look happy too, Big Bird.
Well, I'm happy in the picture, Gordon. Because that's the way things used to be.
And you know what, Big Bird? That's the way things are going to be, too. As soon as we get everything fixed and cleaned up.
Oh, yeah. It's like two pictures. The way it used to be, and the way it's going to be. You know something?
What?
I'm glad I drew this, Gordon.
You know, so am I.
Yeah.
Awesome. So I really love that clip for so many reasons. You know, Gordon and Susan do just the right thing in offering comfort. You know, they offer him simple materials to color a picture. They help see his situation in a different perspective. You know, he's sort of stuck in the past about what he doesn't have, and they're able to see that higher perspective and the future thinking that kids have some struggle with sometimes. So, you know, when you're working with families, and no matter what capacity you're working with families, it's really important that, you know, these families are going through so much, the kids are going through so much, and you might also be going through a lot, but it's really important, and it is really an important role for you to take a step back and help the family think positively about their situation and really offer the resources and the first steps for them to take so that they can also embrace that positive attitude and that I can do it attitude. So the last thing I want to do with you is actually a workshop, and I can't see you, but I'm going to trust that you're actually going to participate, and I hope that this will help you feel good about the work that you do and just reassure you that you really are so important in the lives of these kids and families. So what I want you to do is actually raise your hand. So look at your hands and think about all the ways that you use your hands. So if you're a parent, maybe that's changing dirty diapers. Maybe that's giving a pat on the back. So think about the ways that you use your hands, all the helpful things that you can do with your hands. So once you've got a few things in mind, I want you to just think about those things. You know, we often use our hands to do so many things that are so helpful. And, you know, our hands can help us in times of emergencies as well and after disasters. So I want you to actually trace your hand if you can. If not, just look at your hand, one finger at a time. So on your first finger, I want you to either write or just think about the words helping hands. So this is really about remembering that we're not alone, that there are always helpers around, that you might be a helper in this situation. On the second finger, I want you to write or think about hugs. So hugs are great for feeling safe and secure, for feeling comforted. Hugs can be given to anyone, even to yourself if you need one. The third finger, we're going to write hearts. So, you know, we know that we're all in this together, and this is really about connecting with the people around you and connecting with yourself. You know, how are you feeling? What do you need from others, and what can you offer to others? The fourth thing that your fingers can help you remember is to hear, right? So to listen and really notice that kids, that parents are going through difficult things, and we can be a listening ear. And then finally, the last thing is hear, which is a different hear. So this is really about being present. So even if you don't work directly with families on a daily basis and you're working with providers and other caregivers, we can also be present to them. You know, we can be present to everyone we meet, and that's really about checking in with ourselves, knowing if we're having a hard time reaching out for help when we need it, and then, of course, extending that help in our work and in our daily lives. And finally, the last thing I want to share with you, we just launched a webinar with Andy Rozak from Child Care Aware, and he talks all about handling emergencies, and it's a really great one. If you want to check that out, you can watch the replay anytime and get a certificate for that as well. And that's all I have. Hopefully I didn't go too far over my time, but you can keep in touch with us by sending an email to communities@sesame.org. We have a Facebook group called Sesame Street and Communities, and we also have a providers-only group, Sesame Street Community Providers, that you can join and continue the conversation. And thanks so much, and I'm going to hand it over to Amanda.
Thanks, Tara, and good afternoon, everyone. We're just getting the slideshow set up. I'm really glad to be here with all of you today and thankful for Child Care Aware of America for their important work and for hosting this webinar series. There's been a lot of great resources and information shared already in the series, and I'm really grateful that Camp NOAA can be a part of it. Next slide, please. So today I'll be sharing with you a general overview of Camp NOAA, why it's important, the services we provide and how it works, the positive impact that Camp NOAA makes on children in communities impacted by disaster, and different ways to support Camp NOAA or partner with us to bring Camp NOAA to a community in your area. Next slide. Camp NOAA, in a nutshell, is a resiliency and preparedness program for elementary age children. And children are learning these important skills through an effective and evaluated curriculum in either a day camp or an after school setting. Now, Camp NOAA is intended for children grades K through 5 or K through 6, and we're typically serving 35 to 50 kids per camp. And it's important to note that Camp NOAA isn't a permanent camp site. It is a mobile camp operation that goes to the specific area in need. And so that means that we're sending all of the supplies and all of the materials, the promotional materials and the curriculum guidebooks, all of that is being sent to the host facility that's hosting camp. In addition, the volunteers that are facilitating the camp are also oftentimes coming from out of town to run the Camp NOAA program. Camp NOAA was created in 1997 in response to the flooding in the Red River Valley of the North Dakota-Minnesota border. And it was created through a partnership with LDR, Lutheran Disaster Response, and Lutheran Social Service of Minnesota. So this year, we're celebrating 20 years of helping children across the country build resiliency and restore hope. In those 20 years, we've served over 14,000 children in 29 states and Puerto Rico, and in hundreds of communities with thousands and thousands of volunteers. It really does take a community or a village effort to help children impacted by disaster. So we're hosted in those communities that have been impacted by disaster. We're typically serving communities 6 to 18 months after they've experienced a disaster, and that's during the recovery phase, which we know to be the longest and most under-resourced phase following a disaster. In addition to serving during recovery, Camp NOAA can also be hosted in a community as part of their preparedness planning. It's always ideal if we have the skills and the resources available to us before a disaster hits, but of course it's always important to get those skills at any point, so that's why we're working during the recovery phase as well. Camp NOAA responds to all kinds of disasters. Typically it's natural disasters such as wildfires, floods, tornadoes, and hurricanes. After Hurricane Katrina, we hosted over 100 camps along the Gulf Coast during their recovery. But in addition to natural disasters, we also serve communities that are impacted by collective traumas. And those examples include camps that
served communities like Newtown, Connecticut after the Sandy Hook Elementary School shooting. We've also served in Flint, Michigan multiple times during their ongoing water crisis. And we served different populations that are new to America, so refugee populations, Korean refugees, Somali refugees, new immigrants, and other groups of children. In order to host Camp NOAA in a community, we really rely on strong partnerships with local organizations because we recognize that every community is different, every disaster is different, and the recovery following the disaster is different for each community. So we just want to honor as much as possible the unique makeup of that community to be served, ensuring that the Camp NOAA experience is as relevant and culturally specific for those children as possible. And we do that by providing the curriculum in languages other than English. When requested, we also are very intentional about recruiting volunteers that reflect the culture and the background of the children being served in order to work alongside that specific community to best support their children. Next slide. So why is Camp NOAA important? Well, we know that children are uniquely impacted by disaster and other traumatic events. Children in their childhood, their brains are developing at such a rapid rate, and so structure and routine are so important to that healthy development. And we know all too well that disaster disrupts all of that structure and that routine that is so critical. And that's why disaster can have long-term emotional and behavioral impacts on children. Disaster events can trigger stress responses at very high or very frequent levels of toxic stress, which impacts kind of the long-term damage to a child's development. And so kids really need support and guidance to process what has happened, regardless of what type of disaster or trauma they've experienced. And that's why interventions are needed at multiple points in their recovery. Camp NOAA, of course, is meeting the needs of children as part of their recovery or to help them prepare for potential disasters. Next slide. When parents are registering their children for Camp NOAA, we ask them a question about if they have seen or observed any significant behavioral or emotional changes in their child since the disaster. And most often, we'll see those six emotional and behavioral changes. Children are feeling more scared or vulnerable. They're exhibiting more sleep disturbances or other kind of physical symptoms like headaches and stomach aches, really internalizing that stress and that anxiety that the disaster has caused. They're becoming obsessed with weather, or they're anxious and worried or sad or grieving. And of course, we know that no two children are alike, and we also know that many children experiencing difficulty post-disaster might not necessarily demonstrate observable changes, but that doesn't mean that they weren't impacted or affected by that disaster experience. So our goal at Camp NOAA is beyond the experience of just Camp NOAA itself. What we're doing at Camp NOAA is equipping children with skills to help them process what they've gone through, but also to face future challenges and future disasters with increased resiliency and coping skills. Next slide. So there are three different kind of service delivery options that Camp NOAA has. And we have these three options so that we can best accommodate the need and the preference and capacity of each specific community we're working with. Regardless of the service delivery option chosen, each Camp NOAA experience provides a safe and caring environment for children to help them process their disaster experience and build those resiliency and coping skills. A day of Camp NOAA includes typical day camp activities. There's large group time, small group time, which is akin to kind of cabin groups with their same-aged peers, arts and crafts, recreation, skits, puppet shows, music, And keep in mind that all of the supplies for those activities are sent to that camp. So the first service delivery option we have is the 5-day day camp. That's typically offered in the summer months, although it can be offered over an extended weekend during the school year. And that provides 30 hours of resiliency skill training for children through those different day camp activities. We also have two different after-school programs that we've begun offering, and there's a 1-week option and a 2-week option. The 2-week option is the exact same curriculum and activities in the 5-day day camp. It's just laid out a little bit differently schedule-wise, whereas with a 5-day day camp, we typically are with the kids for 6 hours over 5 days, and the 2-week after-school program, we're with the kids 3 days a week for 3 hours a week for 2 weeks. The 1-week after-school program is a shorter curriculum, which provides about 15 hours of resiliency skill training. And so some activities have been removed or condensed a little bit, and those would be the arts and crafts times and some recreational and large group times. We're working with all sorts of organizations in local communities to host Camp NOAA with one of these three service options. Oftentimes we're working with schools or churches and places of worship, child care centers, community parks and rec departments, and other types of established after-school programs. I should mention, too, before I move on to the next slide, that in addition to these three service delivery options for campers, we provide a parent resource that complements the Camp NOAA camper experience for the kids. And this parent resource is a parent workshop. It was created in response to feedback from parents, and it offers the opportunity to talk with other parents whose children are at Camp NOAA, dialogue about resources that are available in their community, and learn tools for supporting their children after a disaster, kind of reinforcing what's being taught at Camp NOAA. Next slide. So throughout the week, Camp NOAA is promoting and strengthening children's resiliency and coping skills by helping them, 1, identify their unique gifts and talents, 2, processing their disaster experience, and 3, planning for the future and instilling a sense of hope where before they may have been very anxious or afraid about what's to come. We want to redirect them so that they can be excited about the future instead of afraid of it. There is a Camp NOAA handout that was provided to you on the sidebar there, and you'll find in the first document the Camp NOAA FAQs and daily themes. On the daily themes page, you'll see the key resiliency skills that the children are learning and practicing each day. So I really encourage you to take a look at that document. It's important to note, too, that each day of the curriculum is building on the days beforehand. And we use the story of Noah and the flood to guide children through their own disaster experience. I want to talk a little bit about two specific days of camp. The first day I want to talk about is the second day, and the theme of that day is storm stories. And so this is a day where children are really practicing empathy and listening skills, and also those language skills to express themselves and talk about their storm stories. Now, their storm story is self-selected. They get to choose what they want to talk about and how much they want to talk about. And oftentimes, their storm story isn't even related to the disaster that their community has experienced. It could have been something that happened at school or at home, or maybe it was the loss of a loved one or a pet. And that is totally their option, whatever they want to talk about. It's also that same day that children are receiving preparedness backpacks. Now, the phrase of the day on the storm story day is, "When a storm comes, I'm not scared. Want to know why? Because I'm prepared." And the kids really rally around those different phrases of each day, particularly that day, because that backpack to them is really a sign of security and safety, and sometimes just having that by their bed at night is all the comfort that they need to get a good night's sleep, uninterrupted from nightmares and things like that. I also want to talk about day 5. Day five is a great way to end the week of camp. We ended on a high note as we're looking forward to the future. The key resiliency skills that we're talking about that day are identifying future goals, developing action plans to give back, and practicing gratitude. It's often during this day of camp where local community members come in for a closing ceremony with the campers, and the campers get an opportunity to say thank you to first responders or to healthcare providers that may have been a part of that response and recovery of the disaster. It's a really beautiful way to end camp. The supplies and materials that we're providing to the kids throughout the week are really great. The kids love them, they get to use them throughout the week, and then they get to keep them afterwards. So we provide them with a blanket, a fleece blanket, kids' kits, which are a bunch of different school supplies that they use throughout the week of camp, and then they get to keep. They also receive that preparedness backpack, which contains a number of kind of grab-and-go evacuation materials, so a first aid kit, flashlight, hand sanitizer, whistle, things like that. In addition to those supplies and materials that the kids get, we also provide parents with take-home cards. And this is reinforcing the different skills that are taught at camp so that they can practice those at home through different conversations with their children and different activities. We would not be able to do Camp NOAA without our volunteers. There are so many people that work together to make this happen for the children, for the community. And so the team leader and the certified camp staff are the people that are actually facilitating the camp. And oftentimes they're coming from out of town. The team leader is a stipended volunteer position, and all of the facilitating camp staff are background checked and trained on the curriculum. The site coordinator and the coordinating organization are our local contacts in that community, and they really help us prepare for camp, recruit kids to attend camp, set up the logistics for lodging if the volunteers are traveling in from out of town, and arranging the actual site that's hosting camp. A unique aspect of Camp NOAA is that a mental health professional from the community serves on site at Camp NOAA. Sometimes there are children who need additional support, and so that mental health professional is really valuable in being able to provide follow-up with parents and making referrals that are appropriate for that community and for that child. Next slide. So the next few slides, there are just a few different quotes that I've pulled from recent evaluations. At the end of every camp, we survey the volunteers, which we call the certified camp staff. We also do evaluations with the campers and the parents. And in this one, the certified camp staff says, one of the things that really happens that's amazing is that children in a group setting care for each other. Adults that are there are caring for them and supporting them, but they're also caring for each other and showing each other that they are not alone. And I had the ability to go to a few camps this summer and see that for myself happen. It is really incredible for children to practice that empathy, to practice those language skills and express themselves and get the support that they need from kids their same age who understand what they've all gone through. That collective experience is really powerful for them as they recover. Camp NOAA has made a significant impact in its 20-year history, and we find different anecdotes from surveys all the time, and the evaluations that we get back show that overwhelmingly campers are being impacted positively with those resiliency skills that are being taught. Next slide. Here are two different parent quotes. The first one I love says, each day my son learned something new and was very interested and excited about sharing his day. He shares with me how to stay calm. And I just love that kids feel ownership and empowerment over being prepared and being resilient and kind of become ambassadors in their family for their siblings and, yes, even for their parents on how to stay calm and how to be resilient in the face of challenges. Something to note, too, is that in addition to doing evaluations at the end of camp, we do a follow-up with parents 3 months later to see what resiliency skills have stuck with those children, and also those same emotional and behavioral changes that they had seen since the disaster, have any of those been mitigated since Camp NOAA? And we do see a lot of significant changes and mitigation from those behaviors that had originally kind of flared up after the disaster. This parent says, I would recommend this camp to other parents in order for your child to understand where their fears are coming from and how to be able to handle those fears. A lot of parents say in their evaluations to us that they have their child back. They have found their new normal. There's a spring in their step again, and they're excited and bright-eyed again, and that's great to hear. Next slide. The last quote I have here just really talks about how Camp NOAA fills a unique need in focusing on the recovery and resiliency among children during that recovery period. Oftentimes, communities are really focused on that infrastructure piece and rebuilding, and that is so critical, of course, to a recovery, but it's really important to focus on the people, too, and what the people need in order to recover as well, specifically children, because they are so uniquely impacted by those disaster events. The 2016 report, evaluation report that was conducted by Wilder Foundation, found that 98% of campers surveyed learned two or more resiliency skills during Camp NOAA, and 100% of parents said that they would recommend Camp NOAA to other parents. Now you can see more details in our year four review files on campnoaa.org, in addition to the evaluation reports conducted by Wilder Foundation. Next slide. Of course, we love hearing from the kids themselves, so here are just a few quick audio clips of children who are talking about their favorite parts of Camp NOAA.
How old are you?
Six.
What was the best part of Camp NOAA?
The puppet show.
Hello, my name is...
You're okay. You're fine, so keep going.
Hello, my name is Jacob Murray. I am 9. My favorite part of Camp NOAA is the music.
Hi, my name is Emily Hansen. I'm 9, and my favorite part about Camp NOAA is small group time.
Hi, I'm Noah Olson, age 9, and I love Camp NOAA. Love every part about it.
Well, there's something for everyone at Camp NOAA. It's a great experience for all the kids, especially because through all of those different activities, kids are learning those really important and long-lasting resiliency and preparedness skills that will benefit them going forward. Next slide. Camp NOAA lasts a week, but its impact lasts a lifetime, and those resiliency skills are really being used beyond the scope of the disaster and have the ability to change the trajectory of children's lives. Right now, we're preparing for 2018 and the rest of 2017 to host Camp NOAA in communities across the country, and there are a number of ways to get involved. We're looking for local organizations that are interested in hosting a camp. We're looking for individuals and groups who would like to volunteer at camp. And then, of course, we're always looking for in-kind support. Those kids' kits and those blankets that are provided to the children are all donated, and there's no way we would have been able to provide that. And so we are just so fortunate and thankful for all of those individuals and groups that provide that in-kind support with those kids' kits and those blankets. There's also the option to sponsor a camp, and camp is offered free to the children and to the families, but of course it's not a free camp to put on. So we are always interested in finding people that would like to support us and help offset the cost of camp in communities impacted by disaster. And we know that resources can be quite sparse in communities during the recovery phase, which is why it's so great to have groups and people across the country that step in and say, we want to help this community recover and we want to help those children. And then lastly, but certainly not least, it's the promotion and awareness of Camp NOAA. A lot of times, Camp NOAA, unless your community has been impacted and Camp NOAA has been hosted, it's not always a very recognized program on the national level. And so just asking people, hey, have you heard of Camp NOAA, is really great and really helpful to us as we try to raise awareness about the impact of Camp NOAA and how we can serve communities impacted by disaster. Next slide. So thank you for allowing me to share with you about Camp NOAA today. I really appreciate your time. Here's my contact information and the general Camp NOAA contact information. We are here to answer any questions you might have, provide you with more information, or to work with you to bring Camp NOAA to your area to help children in the face of disaster. I hope to hear from you about how we can serve children impacted by disaster in your region. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Amanda. At this time, I'd like to welcome Tara to answer any questions that she's received regarding her work.
Thanks so much again for having me today. I just have a couple of questions here in the chat box. The first one is, are these videos available in Spanish? And I should have mentioned that, yes. So all of the videos that we went through today on both of the websites are available in Spanish as well as English, and they are all available completely for free, so you won't ever have to pay any for anything from us. And the second question is, how can we order the free Sesame Street materials? So this is a great question. As I said, we do have the emergency preparedness and emergency response toolkits available in print. And you can order those by sending an email to jessica@sesame.org. That's Jessica, J-E-S-S-I-C-A, at sesame.org. And if you'll list your name, your organization, your phone number and address, and then what toolkits you're interested in, we will connect with you and make sure we get those shipped out to you. And again, those are free of charge. And that's all the questions I have.
Thanks, Tara. Amanda, please go ahead with any questions that you've received on your presentation.
Sure, so I have a question here about the list of items in the child's backpack. If you email me directly, I have a nice handout, or if that could be included in the PDF handout that I already provided, I'll see if Child Care Aware can include that in that PDF file. Otherwise, you can just email me directly and I can send you that list of the specific items. I have a question here about, does Camp NOAA have a religious component? And that's a great question. Camp NOAA is owned and operated on a national basis by Lutheran Social Service of Minnesota. And even though the name is Camp NOAA and we use the story of Noah and the flood, it is a program intended for all children in the community. There is a faith-based Christian supplement that can be incorporated if it is being hosted in a church and that specific community would like to have a faith theme to camp. But as it stands, the standard curriculum is meant for all children. We've hosted Camp NOAA in communities on Native American Indian reservations. We've worked with Karen refugee children, Somali refugee children using our standard curriculum, and we're finding that as it is, the standard curriculum is still just as effective. I have a question about the training for the volunteers. They are typically trained through online modules and videos, but if we are able, it's great to always host in-person training for those volunteers that will be facilitating camp. I have a question about, are locations responsible for providing their own sponsor? We work in partnership with a lot of great national organizations in the disaster response and recovery field. And so oftentimes those costs are shared and divided out between a number of different partners so that we can make camp as cost effective as possible for the community, especially as they're going through that recovery phase. Yes, there's a question here about where do the emails go if you submit them online on our website, campnoaa.org. I get a copy of them in my inbox, so you can email that general Camp NOAA email. Volunteers, this is a great question about volunteers. They pay a $225 stipend, and that's covering their background checks, the curriculum, the training, things like that. They are on their own for their travel to that community. The meals provided during the camp hours are provided by that site, but in the evenings they're on their own. And so a lot of times groups that are volunteering will be doing a lot of fundraising in the weeks or months in advance so that they can share those costs, those travel costs and those food costs. The lodging, I should note, is provided by the site, and so that varies depending on the community that is hosting Camp NOAA. Sometimes it's a gym with Red Cross cots. That is one experience I had this summer at a Camp NOAA. At another Camp NOAA, I was in a hotel, and so it really depends on the capacity of the community that's hosting that camp. My email address is amanda.allen@lssmn.org. And that stands for, there it is on the screen, Lutheran Social Service, Minnesota. I'm just looking over the remaining questions to make sure I haven't missed anything.
Thanks, Amanda.
Yeah, thank you.
Absolutely. Again, I'd like to thank you all for attending today's session. For any questions or information about the upcoming webinars, please visit www.childcareprepare.org. This concludes today's presentation.